Okay, and the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 13063 in the name of Claire Adamson on Child Safety Week 2024. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Claire Adamson to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms. Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's a privilege to open this debate marking Child Safety Week, the flagship annual campaign that is led by the Child Accident Prevention Trust, CAPT. This year, Child Safety Week runs from the 3rd to the 9th of June, and the theme for 2024 is Safety Sorted. Can I begin by thanking all of the safety campaigners who work for accident prevention to be where it must be in our political agenda. Preventative spend, as we've just heard from the previous debate, is always the smart spend. I give special mention to the cross-party group of accident prevention and safety awareness for their dedication from all of their members, both those from charities, those who volunteer and those who work in our emergency services. And can I also thank my MSP colleagues for signing the motion and for those who will be contributing to the debate this evening. Safety Sorted, the 2024 theme, encourages family to feel confident that with a small change, they can stop a serious accident and be clear what they need to do to help keep children safe. This reflects a message from safety campaigners that accidents, or otherwise known as unintentional injury, are not inevitable. Small changes can dramatically reduce unintentional injury. Since we last held a debate on Child Safety Week, arguably the biggest legislative change has been the domestic implementation of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. Embedding these core children's rights in Scots law marks a significant milestone for this Parliament. We know that children from more deprived areas are disproportionately impacted by accidents and unintentional injury. This is a poverty and social justice related issue. And that basic social inequity underlies the need for rights-based legislation to be at the heart of Scottish policy. I'm keen to remind people that Article 24 of the Convention states to ensure that all segments of society, in particular parents and children, are informed, have access to education and are supported in the use of basic knowledge in a number of areas, including the prevention of accidents. Since the last Child Safety Week debate, there have been new developments with implications for child safety. I did not envisage that vaping would be so extant a child safety concern. Vaping companies are transparently targeting younger people with flashy marketing, colours and flavours. And the Child Action Prevention Trust has previously warned that hospitals are seeing a growing number of children accidentally swallowing liquid nicotine from e-cigarette refills. To anyone questioning the need for regulation, I contend that vapes are being used to save the tobacco industry from a societal shift in consumer attitudes to smoking. The smoking cessation argument falters when you consider that a huge proportion of new vape users have never smoked. We cannot allow the next generation to bear the brunt of health, social, environmental and economic costs. I'm heartened that the Scottish Government is consulting on a ban for single-use vapes, and we reiterate the calls for tougher regulatory framework to assist organisations like Trading Standards deal with the problem of underage sales. If I turn to some of the common dangers for children, which are highlighted in Child Safety Week, and we all know, parents especially, that bumps, scrapes and bruises are a part of growing up, it's how children interact with their world. But we learn the consequences of our actions. We become more alert to dangers, we grow, we become more hopefully more cautious and more risk averse. Thousands of injuries each year are avoidable. They are a huge economic cost to our health service, potentially life-changing impacts on children and their families. And Child Safety Week is first and foremost about raising awareness so that parents and carers can look through the resources produced this week from organisations such as CAPT and RoSPA Scotland, who have a host of free information and advice. Tips on the dangers in the home, from scalds and burns, falls, poisoning, choking hazards, to road safety around animals, safety around children with animals and drowning prevention. There are simply proactive measures to ensure that you and your child can avoid injury. We have had recurring themes in this chamber. Button batteries are a notorious danger and they are hazardous for toddlers and they are easily swallowed. And we know all too well that this can lead to tragedy with chemicals that burn through tissue very quickly. And the dangers, the Scottish Government have been working with their cross-party group to ensure that information is there for parents around button batteries, and this information is now included in the baby box. This is an important step. There is a pervasive problem in safety regulations on online marketplaces. We have an ever-increasing number of gadgets in our home, but substandard and fake goods are readily available online, and this extends to children's products. People are understandably looking to make savings amid financial pressures, but I would urge people to stick to trusted traders and transparent safety standards. There is a consumer assumption that a product designed for children will have gone through safety testing. Research from CAP shows that more than half of parents mistakenly believe that sellers online adhere to standards like the CE mark. But almost three quarters of parents wrongly believe that a product aimed at children under five has to have been fully tested and certified before it can be sold online. Members will know that road safety is dear to my heart. Now, Mother and Wishaw constituency, parents and carers have expressed serious concerns about proposals to increase the distance at which school transport is provided. On Friday, I walked with several parents and pupils from Cathedral Primary to their homes in North Lodge, and I saw the impact that this would have on primary pupils. We have to consider this when we're making changes to policy. During that, we had to walk alongside very, very fast roads, people speeding, obviously, on it, and also going across a Pelican's crossing, we had to traverse around a car that had stopped in the middle of that Pelican crossing. Not a safe route for young people and children to be following. As you know, Presiding Officer, I could go on in ad infinitum about safety issues and all the areas there, and I'm sure some of my colleagues this evening will pick up on areas that I've not been able to touch, such as water safety. But I thank everyone for their contributions this evening. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. We move to the open debate. I call first Ros McCall to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Around 4 minutes, Ms McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to Claire Adamson for bringing this debate to Chamber. I thought that was a very interesting opening contribution, especially highlighting the concerns for vapes around young people, which I think is something that's very prevalent. I'm always happy to speak in the Chamber regarding the well-being of Scotland's children, including all aspects of keeping children safe. And I commend the work of the Child Accident Prevention Trust for their continuing work in this, and particularly in this year's Child Safety Week, where the theme, already stated, is safety sorted. To use the words of Child Accident Prevention Trust, it's an annual community education campaign acting as a catalyst for thousands of safety conversations and activities UK-wide. And it is this conversation and recognition to all the little issues in and around our homes and our communities that is so important. When I was young, television wasn't broadcast all day. We had three channels, and a test card picture was the most viewed item on the screen. Our choice was limited. No breakfast television, no 24-hour children's TV. We had a close down of broadcasting after lunchtime news, and programming restarted most afternoons about 4 o'clock. The reason I mention this is at the start of the afternoon session, before play school adorned the screen, there was a public information film. It meant that children, pretty much all over the country, just in from school, were watching a repetitive short cartoon highlighting the dangers of various household items or crossing the road or playing near water. Many an afternoon I watched Charlie, an animated cut-out cat, protect his owner from the perils of talking to strangers or standing too close to hot things in the kitchen, or even playing with matches, and I'll never forget the Charlie Says phrase which ended every film. They must have worked, because the information in these films has stayed with me all my life. This is not something we can now continue to do, as we'll never have the ability to ensure that a simple 60-second message is replayed and relayed to parents and children on a daily basis ever again. And this is why the action from groups like the Child Accident Prevention Trust is so vital. This year's campaign, Safety Sorted, is focused on helping families feel confident that with one small change, they can stop a serious accident from ever happening, and to be clear what they need to do to keep their children safe. The Parents Pack is excellent. It covers all the points you can think of and just what to do. How to prevent your child from choking and what to do if the unthinkable happens. How to prevent poisoning from laundry products, cleaning products and medicines by storing products out of reach of nimble little fingers. And understanding that children learn more about texture, feel and taste by putting items in their mouth than by simply holding them in their hands. And how to change the way we view hot items. How we can do little things to make a difference and to keep children away from them. Turn the handle of the pan round if it's a pan of boiling water. Make sure your cup of tea is pushed a little bit further back when it comes to putting it on the side table. Put cold water in the bath first before topping it up with hot to make sure that the bath isn't too hot for little bodies. It's an excellent booklet of safety tips that we should all be aware of. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I applaud the work done. I'm proud to take the opportunity to highlight this worthwhile campaign to keep all our children safe. The conversation must be had to raise awareness, and I'm delighted in some small way to have added my voice to that today so that we can actually get safety sorted.
Thank you, Ms McCall. I now call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Martin Whitfield, around 4 minutes. Ms Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to start by congratulating my good friend and colleague, Claire Adamson, on securing this member's debate on Child Safety Week 2024. As I went back to look at the motion text last night, I was reminded that Claire Adamson has also put in motions about Child Safety Week before. In fact, every year for the last 10 years, and I totally understand why. Claire Adamson bravely spoke previously of her family's loss and experience and the importance of road safety, and I want to applaud her for her continued, consistent and passionate advocacy of Child Safety Week and using her platform as an MSP to promote safety for children and young people. As Claire Adamson has already outlined, the theme of this year's Child Safety Week is Safety Sorted. The campaign aims to make families feel confident that one small change, they can stop a serious accident and be clear what they need to do to keep their children safe. Some of the posters that go alongside the event show don't need words. They simply show a wide range of small changes that can be made to protect children. Those include making sure hot drinks aren't placed near edges, tying up blind cords, putting cleaning products out of reach, and making sure battery covers are properly secured. The materials go on to give numerous more tips and information, some of which are well known but well worth repeating, and some that I have to admit I hadn't even thought of. The dangers of button batteries, how to keep them away from small children, and what to do if one gets swallowed, or as the leaflet says, look, check, store, dispose and act. The risks posed by water beads, which can swell up to the size of a golf ball. The importance of keeping nappy sacks well away from babies, because they will grab onto just about anything and bring it to their mouths, and nappy sacks can cling. The risks posed by magnets, especially powerful ones. About dog triggers times, when children should be taught to leave dogs alone, when they're sleeping, eating, getting a treat, or playing with certain toys that they might not want to share. How to cut foods, not just grapes, but also other foods like sausages too. They should all be cut in half long ways, then cut in half long ways again. That 30 children go to hospital with hot drink burns every day. How to cross a road safely. Think, stop, look and listen. Wait, then look and listen again. And how to secure blind cords safely. The whole Child Accident Prevention Trust website has a wealth of helpful information across a range of areas, not just those I've already mentioned, but also fire safety, falls, beach safety, and so on. All of this is information that will help to save lives if it is seen more widely, which is the point of this Child Safety Week and of this member's debate. It is to raise awareness of these small steps that we can take to reduce the chances of an accident happening. Presiding Officer, again, I'd like to say thank you to Clare Adamson for securing this member's debate, meaning that we are able to stand in the Chamber of Scotland's Parliament to share this advice and highlight where it can be found. And I hope that this will make a difference and help to protect children from accidents.
Thank you, Ms Dunbar. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Bob Doris. Around 4 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I too congratulate Clare Adamson on securing this debate this evening. And it's a pleasure to follow Jackie Dunbar, and I'd like to echo the tribute that she gave to the member for both securing this debate this evening, but also for the facts that she shared over a long period of time and her interest in this matter. It is very powerful to young people to hear adults talking about their safety, to holding them out and asking us to consider that. And as stated, we have the week between the 3rd and the 9th of June, which this year is orientated towards safety sorted. The idea that we educate ourselves, that we spread awareness, that we engage with children, such an important part of this, that we organise within our own communities, but also that we undertake home safety checks, the child passenger safety, as already discussed, the safe routes to school, but also for this year to talk about online safety for our young people, which is so important. There is one Scottish child dying a month from accidents and one in seven emergency admissions due to accidents. And the work of the Child Accident Prevention Trust is vital to support parents and families to understand, to navigate the risks of modern family life. And Child Safety Week is a welcome opportunity to highlight the work that the Trust and many other organisations are doing, and as colleagues have done, to highlight the resources online and in leaflets, and that these organisations have created so that access for parents and families is so much easier. Because it is right that the Public Health Scotland data shows that for 22-23, children aged under 15 living in our most deprived areas are more likely than children in the least deprived areas to have an emergency admission to hospital for an unintentional injury. And the standardised discharge ratio was 19% higher in the most deprived areas compared to the Scottish average. And in the least deprived areas, the discharge ratio was 19% lower. And it is right that Clare Adamson has mentioned the UNCRC, a most important step that has taken place. And I would like to draw those watching attentions to both Article 6 and 19, which sit within the jigsaw of rights, because every child has an inherent right to life, and that every party within a state should ensure to the maximum extent possible the survival and development of a child. And Article 19 requires appropriate legislative, administrative, social, education measures to protect a child from all forms of physical, mental violence, injury and abuse, neglect, or indeed negligent treatment, maltreatment or exploitation. And this is important because from next month, this must sit at the heart of legislation that is passed in this Parliament. But there is good news, and I want to take the opportunity to mention the Risk Factory in Edinburgh, which opened its doors in 2007 for Primary 7 pupils from Edinburgh and the Lothians to attend. And they've welcomed over 100,000 pupils into the centre. And I know this because I had a group of P7s in that first year go to the Risk Factory. And it was at that first time as frightening experience for me as I think it was for the children. But the staff that work in that building, that allow young people to discover risk in a safe, supported environment, allow them to question it, allow them to make fools of themselves sometimes, but to take away really important messages that, like Charlie the cat that leaves us the bones of a fish at the door, they will remember for the whole of their lives. And it is important that organisations, that groups exist in our communities to support our young people and our children's development to safety. And it is most important, as already been said, that we take every opportunity to highlight all of the good work, give the warnings that are necessary, and point to the resources that are out there. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield. We now come to the final speaker in the open debate, Bob Doris. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr Doris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I hadn't intended speaking in the this evening's debate, but having listened to Claire Adamson's opening speech, I was just struck by how much work Claire has done in this area over many years. And the least I could do was stick around and make a contribution. So can I thank Claire Adamson for not just this motion and Child Safety Week 2024, but her work in a variety of areas of safety, not just child safety, but accident prevention more generally, on electrical safety or water safety, and the list goes on. So I think we should all owe Claire Adamson a debt of gratitude for her sterling work in this area. I think if ever we wanted a colleague in our Parliament to risk assess our home or workplace, Claire Adamson might just be the very person to do that. But of course, Claire's campaign is to ask us all in our everyday life to risk assess what we do as individuals with our children, with our families, on a day-to-day basis, and make the most reasonable of adjustments. And I just want my brief contribution to talk about one area of safety, child safety, that I will touch on in a members' debate in a few weeks' time in this place. And that debate will be on the use and misuse of off-road vehicles. It doesn't really focus on children and young people particularly, but there's clearly, as I was listening to Claire speak, a very clear link there in relation to that. And I should point out that most people who use off-road vehicles do so responsibly. They don't always do so legally, I should point out, or unwittingly they are unsafe as they do that, be that actually without even off-road vehicles, just kids on scooters or on bicycles, or the increasing proliferation of the battery-powered propelled scooters and the Deliveroo powered bikes, which are illegal on the roads. They can do up to 30 to 40 miles an hour, and kids can also get hold of some of these things as well, and they're at risk. For the kids, it's just fun, it's adventure, but it's deeply dangerous. Now, my debate in a few weeks' time will look at the wider issues in relation to that, and look at the UK potentially being able to register such off-road vehicles in Scotland, about effective policing and licensing of misdemeanours in relation to such vehicles. But for today, I was actually thinking about just education and positive messages and children and families being aware of the dangers, whether it's a scooter, whether it's a bicycle, whether it's a dirt bike, whether it's an off-road vehicle. You do see wee kiddies on quad bikes in the streets, which, you know, I've got a bit of concern about more generally, but not even a helmet on. So as I was listening to Claire Adamson give her fantastic opening speech to this debate, I just thought that we should be making common cause in these areas across the Parliament and between Parliaments, given the reserved aspects of some of this as well. So thank you, Claire Adamson, for all your work in this area. And I suppose I'm trying to twist your arm to speak in my debate in a few weeks' time also. I'm happy to support your motion this evening.
Thank you, Mr Doris. An ingenious trailer for a future members' debate. I now call on Natalie Dawn to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I firstly thank Ms Adamson for highlighting the important issue of Child Safety Week campaign that runs from the 3rd to the 9th of June this year. And I'd just like to echo the words and sentiments of Jackie Dunbar, Bob Doris and Martin Whitfield in relation to Ms Adamson's commitment and dedication to this. Keeping children and young people safe from accidental harm at home or in their communities is and will remain an important issue for the Scottish Government. I certainly know that keeping our children safe from harm is a huge worry for parents and carers. We have a shifting landscape and perhaps less obvious dangers than previously. And other members have noted some of the key dangers, including road safety, safety in the home. But we have newer concerns too. As members have noted, we have vapes, online safety and off-road vehicle usage. I see the Scottish Government's focus as imperative and truly value the hard work of groups and organisations to raise awareness around certain safety issues, many of which, as I've said, we've heard here in today's debate. We recognise the important role that independent charities like Child Accident Prevention Trust, or I'll refer to going forward as CAT, play in raising awareness of child safety issues. Accidents can happen at home, but there are lots of things we can do to lower the risk of them happening. And we've used the Scottish Government's parent information platform, Parent Club, to provide up-to-date advice on this topic to parents. The team who developed this have also been working with our partners, the Royal Society for the Prevention of Accidents and the Child Accident Prevention Trust, to produce advice to help parents and practitioners to keep children safe. And I am particularly grateful to CAPT and RoSPA for supporting our action to strengthen the safety messaging in Scotland's baby box for parents on the dangers of button batteries. Since October 2022, every baby box supplied to parents includes a leaflet highlighting the dangers of button batteries, as well as practical safety advice to keep children safe. We've also taken action to ensure that no loose button batteries are provided in Scotland's baby box. We introduced a measure with our baby box managing agent to ensure that all button batteries are fitted before inclusion in the baby box to remove any possible risk of a child being able to access a button battery in the packaging. CAPT also contributed to the Building Safer Communities strategy that ran from 2016 to 2022. During this period, CAPT helped raise awareness on important issues like the dangers of button battery ingestion, choking and falls. And this aimed to provide parents with helpful resources to manage these risks. Alongside promoting this topic as part of the annual Child Safety Week, the Child Accident Prevention Trust have also in previous years run community-based activities with partners. And this included delivery of child safety talks to local baby massage groups, home and car seat safety groups for new mothers, and supporting the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service to distribute child safety information at local breakfast clubs in Glasgow. While CAPT play an important role campaigning to raise awareness during Child Safety Week, the business of keeping children and young people safe from harm needs to be in the forefront of parents' and practitioners' minds all year round. And the Building Safer Community Strategy initiative was completed in 2022. But since then, the Scottish Government's strategy for supporting parents has evolved, and child safety is now embedded in a range of core strategies. Similarly, how parents access information about child safety has changed over time. As a result, partners in health and early years work closely with the Scottish Government to maintain and promote content via the Parent Club website and NHS Inform. These platforms and associated social media ensure parents and practitioners have access to the most current safety information and guidance all year round. And I've heard firsthand how much a hugely valued resource this is for so many parents. From my own personal experience, I know that little ones have little hands that like to get in everywhere. They treat the house as a soft play. And when I let go of my two-year-old's hand now, I turn round and he is off. So I definitely have a runner. So any advice on keeping children safe is very much welcomed. Supporting parents of young children to understand how to prevent accidents in the home is an important message. And for some families, this might require additional support to make some changes. Health visitors, family nurses and other services which are provided within the home are vital routes to get these key messages shared and acted upon. Those contacts provide opportunities to discuss a whole range of topics, including home safety. Optimising home environments is part of our ambition to improve early child development alongside supporting parents to act on other known prevention activity such as car safety. Now, as has been noted today by some members, according to the most recent Public Health Scotland statistics on unintentional injuries, these do continue to decrease over time, but children and the elderly are most vulnerable to accidents. And there is a strong deprivation gradient for these in children. In 2022 to 23, children aged under 15 living in the most deprived areas were more likely than children in the least deprived areas to have an emergency admission to hospital for an unintentional injury. So I believe, therefore, that we still have work to do in this regard. But I'm positive that the actions that were taken both through our focus on prevention, child poverty, and through our early child development transformational change programme are and will be instrumental in terms of shaping policies and interventions to give all children the best start in life. I also think that Ms Adamson and Mr Whitfield are right to bring up UNCRC legislation and the positive impacts that this could have. So in closing, I'd just like to once again thank Ms Adamson for raising the profile of Child Safety Week and to Child Accident Prevention Trust for their work on building the Safer Communities strategy. The time and energy that all partners put into raising awareness of potential risks and the practical steps that parents can take to avoid child injury or hospital admissions is invaluable. The Scottish Government will be continuing to support Child Safety Week and helping to amplify key messages and resources, and we remain committed to child safety and supporting parents, carers and practitioners on a year-round basis. Going forward, we'll continue to work with parents and practitioners on the issues that matter most and the creation of accessible information on the Parent Club platform. And I'd encourage all members to share that information because we all have influential and wide-reaching connections in our constituencies. At a policy level, we will continue to learn and ensure that we're staying abreast of emerging issues for the benefit of our children, our young people and our families. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate and I close this meeting of Parliament.